Sit.
I would just eat until I'm dead, probably. A normal day for me is wake up around 12, figure out something I'm gonna eat immediately. TV, video games, bed. It's not a lot of activity. It's hot in Georgia. And all my clothing is restricting and tight. So I just sit in there naked, free as can be, and no one bothers me, door shut, we're good. I'm just safe. And video games are where I escape.
Oh no, he's got it. Oh God, he's got that one gun that's gonna kill me. Oh no, he's weak, but I'm weak. I'm weak. Oh, I'm gonna die. He's down. All right, I gotta go in the kitchen and get stuff. All right, I'll be right back.
I'm accepted in all those virtual reality worlds and the gaming world I'm in. No one sees me. No one sees me. That is my outside. That is my world that I can be the Casey I want to be, but not be judged on my weight. I never would have thought at 34 I'd be living with my father and I'd be have no job, have no real money, and just be playing video games all day and eating. I've always been a big kid. Out of high school, I was probably 300 something pounds. But then I got out of school, got a couple jobs at a couple restaurants. I ate at them. I was probably around 500 pounds then, and it was just getting too difficult to work, so I quit my job. My mom said, to live in this house, you have to have a job. So she kicked me out, and the only place I had left to go was my father's. So I went there. Basically, his one thing that knew made me happy was food. So we just ate like kings, but like in the worst way. Pizzas, chicken, Japanese food, takeout. I mean, me and my dad would get hibachi delivered, sushi by the barrel. I mean, just anything you wanted to eat, we were getting.
Oh my God, Nanners, where are you? Nanners, this isn't even a real game. Why are you not just pushing these people with me?
Casey, I got your food.
Oh, okay.
All right, they got the drinks. I don't know which one's tea and which one's Dr. Pepper. You have to look in and see. He'll tell me what to get him, and I come right back a lot of times in case that's too much food. But I'll get it for him and bring it to the house and put it right in front of him. He's my son. I love him. I love to make him happy, you know. And food's got a lot to do with his happiness, but he's like an addict about food.
Well, I have bad news. You did not get your right order.
Are you kidding me?
No, you didn't, because if you ordered yourself a meal, it's not in here.
Well, whatever.
Here you go. There's your lunch.
I don't want to call him an enabler, but I mean, sometimes that's really the way it seems and it is. I'm not buying the groceries. I'm not buying the frozen pizzas. I'm not buying the chicken wings. There's someone facilitating the food coming in, and it's not me. It's someone else.
I'll let you know what we're going to do as far as supper.
Yeah.
You know, he's 34 years old, and, you know, he ought to be taking responsibility more than what he's doing.
Hey, will you come get this out of here? This is not like the other way.
All right. You threw in everything?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's good.
Food is so much more a part of me than I want it to be. I mean, it's killing me, but like, it's like a drug. You don't even notice it. Now, there are moments afterwards where like, I've ate so much where I feel sick.
Okay.
But I don't mind overeating and just going and throwing up in the bathroom. No big deal. It's all coming back out. It didn't affect me. If I could just eat, not gain weight, would be fantastic. But do I want to be fat forever? No. I wish I wasn't in the situation that I'm in. So I bathe outside of this trough currently because I cannot physically bathe in a sit-down bathtub or stand-up shower area.
Oh, this is slippery. Oh.
Oh. Because I'm a bigger guy with like folds and flaps, and I have to move around, like almost like a pig in a way, and wallow and roll over to get like the back of my leg. I have to lift up literal like pieces of skin. It's just a super difficult process. There's two times when I've been kind of stuck in the shower and I couldn't get up. I sat in there for like 9 hours, just couldn't get up. And I can't ask my dad to get me up. And we were like, I was like, Dad, I'm afraid to get back in there again. He's like, well, I got this thing I can buy.
It gets old, and I get tired of it, and he should be more active. But he's not. He's just there. He's just there. And I wait on him hand and foot, and I shouldn't do it, but I do. Whew. I love him to death, he's my son, and I feel obligated to wait on him. I shouldn't feel that way. I wished I didn't. I shouldn't, but I do.
Me and my dad's relationship is it's kind of touch and go. Like sometimes we'll have great moments together, and then recently in these past like years, there's a lot of like negativity and anger and frustration. But now I'm at a size to where I need him to help me do things that just no parent wants to be doing when you're in your 30s or whatever.
Just pour it on my head.
On your head?
Yeah.
All right. Check it out, make sure.
Yeah, just pour it on my head. All right, slowly. On my back. Yeah.
I need his help a little bit to clean myself. You know, wiping, just my ass. Because, I mean, I can't reach everything on my back and I can't reach everything below me. So, you know, it's whatever. Yeah, man. I'm all for a man having surgery, and I know she needs it to save her life, but it's just a scary thing to think of.
All right.
I've never had surgery, never been anesthesia, something I've never even thought about. All those things are foreign to me, and it's scary.
Okay. All right.
Be careful on that hardwood floor when you go in there, because you might slip. You hear me? Be careful, son, all right?
Yeah.
I want him to have a normal life, and that's not normal. Now, things can't go on the way they're going right now. I mean, we've got to make some drastic changes.